among men. Well, Jesus, you know, as you're looking below, it's worse now than then. Pushing and shoving, it's crowding my mind. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking from you. Help me today to do everything that I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. Help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. To tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so kind and true, I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. Of everything, his name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Every day he comes to me with new assurance. More and more I learn to trust his saving grace. But I'll never know just why he came to save me. Till someday, at last I see his blessed face. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, my master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. Why, he's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is he. Bow down before him. Love and adore him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord.
truest thing. Earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God shall make all things new that way. Gone is that curse from which we stumbled and fell. All evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. Praises to our great Lamb. We shall live in His light of the risen Lamb. See all around how the nations bow down to sing. The only sound is the praises to Christ, our King. Slowly those names from His book are read. Is yours there? I know the King. There's no need to dread.
No better message we could have than this message and song to start it off, and no better person to give it to us. Thank you so much for coming today to this special celebration of the life of our dear brother Marian Wojnarowski. On behalf of the family and friends, thank you for those of you that have traveled, rearranged your schedules to be here, for all the prayers that have been offered up. We so sincerely appreciate that. If you're able to, would you mind standing together with me? We're going to open in prayer, and I'd ask Tom if he'd like to come and make ready to lead us in our congregational hymn here in just a moment. But let's ask the Lord to bless our time together today. Father, we thank you for this truth in song. We thank you for the victory that you've given over death and hell and the grave. We thank you for the promise of eternal life that even now our dear brother is enjoying as he beholds your face. I pray that as we mourn, he's not mourning, Lord, but as we mourn, I pray that you give us your grace, your presence. May we sense you near to us. May you bless those that are going to speak today, that are going to minister to us in song. May all of it be done to glorify you and to help us. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're able to remain standing while we sing, we're going to be in hymn 91, or the words will be up on the screen as we sing What a Day That Will Be.
Number 91 in your hymnal. What a day that will be when our Jesus we will see. Let's sing together now.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
No more sorrow. Say amen this morning.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Now I feel at home right here. Reverend Marion Edmund, you didn't know that, did you? Edmund. Named after my father's brother who died at an early age. 83, Parma, Ohio. Passed away peacefully on January 24th, 2023. Surrounded by his loving family. He was born October 17th, 1939 in Cleveland, Ohio. To the late Marion J. and Sophia T. Wojnarowski. I won't say the Polish pronunciation, Wojnarowski, but. My mother's maiden name was Gretsch. Marion will be deeply missed by his beloved wife of 63 years in 2 weeks, Carolyn Wojnarowski, my wife's sister. Her maiden name was Dunikowski. That's really Polish, isn't it? Loving father of Timothy Wojnarowski, Michaela, his wife, Thomas Joy, our song leader. Where's Tommy? Okay. And Joy, his wife. Matthew Wojnarowski, Rachel, his good wife. Mary Beth Fail, husband David, also a preacher. Mark Wojnarowski, where's Mark? And Tiffany, there they are. Cherished grandfather of Tamara, Michael, the husband. Aubrey, married to Sean. Anthony, Jenna, Thomas II, married to Jessica. Where are you at, Tommy? There you are. Charity, married to Bruce. Adam, one of our Air Force men, married to Lindsay. Gracie, I call her Elizabeth Grace. Gracie Garrett, married to Garrett, pardon me. Benjamin, Tabitha, married to Nate, going on their fourth child already. Wow. Gabriel, Abigail, some of these are biblical names, huh? Melody, Tiffany, married to Zach. Taylor, our dear deceased one. Michael, Tristina, Samuel, Tara, Tessa, Bethany, Luke, Cassidy, Toby, Talia, one of our Chinese deaf girls at Mary Beth, went all the way over there twice to get these kids. Jacob, Elijah, cherished great-grandfather of Kylie, Kinsley, Avery, Amelia, Sophie, Thomas III, Caitlin, Jacob, Isabella, Elania, Noah, not the Ark, Alice, he's not that old, Reese, Brian, Harper, Owen, Oliver, Leo, and Finley, plus two unborn on the way. Dear brother of Reverend David, Clarice, my dear wife, thank you, my friends, for coming here. With their children, David, my deceased son, Daniel, with Tanya, and Charmaine. Are you here, Charmaine? Where are you at? Oh, there you are, the pretty one. With Thomas, her husband, Formicola, and their children, my niece and nephew, Andrea and Benjamin, and a host of extended family and many dear friends. Wow. I mean, that's one. And Charmaine, did I mention you? I thought you were in here. I mean, Deborah, my daughter. I'm going to hear about this. Well, let me hurry along because we don't have a lot of time. I have a few things I want to say, not long, maybe 5 minutes. But I'm the little brother. Everyone's telling all about the nice things about Mary and his good works, his, all the accolades. Let me tell you about some of the bad stuff. When we were kids and young men growing up, I won't tell you that. You know I won't. But I've got a lot on him, I'll tell you. He's the man that God brought into this world to spread the gospel of Jesus. I know he made a homemade pipe bomb one time with an open end, and he said, "Go on, Dave, light that thing. I still have scars all over my hand." Or us running around shooting our BB gun at everything that moved, including ourselves. Or how we crossed the train tracks to go to the woods, and the trains were slamming together and moving, and we're under those things crawling around. I'll tell you, we walked on the canal. We couldn't swim, but we walked across the locks, and the canal was always full. We would have drowned. God had different plans, didn't he? After his conversion, he put this sign on the back of his car, a big wooden sign. "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me," said Jesus. Nobody does that. But Marion, you know how unique he is. Let me hurry along. And he wanted people to know Jesus in a personal way. And what's wrong with that? Is there anything wrong with that? He was a good artist. I've got a picture he drew for my mother-in-law. Beautiful little, he drew this real quickly. You didn't see that, did you? Sorry. And he was a funny man. I mean, he could make anyone laugh. He protected me many times. We got in fights as kids, and one time I was a teenager, and this guy beat me up at 64th Park in Harvard, and he kicked me and beat me up real badly, and my brother took him the next day, rammed him up against the backstop of the ball field. He said, "You ever touch my brother again, I'll kill you." He was an accordion player. At revival meetings, he played the cordovox, sang. You heard him sing. What a beautiful voice. He collected 45 and 33 RPM records. He liked pets. He loves his little Rusty at home. And he loved my cat, Ziggy. We went to the same college together. We graduated together, Baptist Bible College. And of all the people that were there on graduation, thousands of people, professors, great preachers. My brother was the class speaker. And what he preached about, the title he uses, "Preach the Word, Be Instant in Season and Out of Season. Reprove, Rebuke, Exhort with All Long-Suffering." What a preacher. They had a financial difficulty going down with four kids. Mark was born there in Missouri. And yet they struggled, and he worked it out and graduated from school. We married sisters, my brother and I. We were both called to preach together. We were both ordained together. And we both have our crypt down here down the street, all four of us, right in the wall. We're inseparable. Even though he's gone, we're still inseparable. We graduated from the same high school and college. We threw snowballs at these two girls when they were little kids going to school. Who would have known we would have married them? And then both became preachers, and they became pastors' wives. I'm almost done. We talked every day on the phone. Yesterday, my wife said, "Did you call your brother?" And then she stopped. Ever since my son died, my brother called me every day. He spent thousands and thousands and thousands of hours on preparing sermons from the Bible. And there must have been 40, 50, 60,000 people over his ministry that trusted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. A unique man. I could go on and on. Just want to read as I close. I used to play this song, and my wife and I sang it. The last mile of the way. If I walk in the pathway of duty, if I work till the close of the day, I shall see the great King in his beauty when I walk the last mile of the way. If for Christ I proclaim the glad story, if I seek for his sheep gone astray, I am sure he will show me his glory when I've gone the last mile of the way. When I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the close of the day. And I know that there are joys that await me when I've gone the last mile of the way. The last two verses. We're all walking through life, aren't we? Which way are you walking? I hope it's up the upward way. Here the dearest of ties we must sever. Tears of sorrow are seen every day, but no sickness, no sighing forever when I've gone the last mile of the way. And if here I have earnestly striven and have tried all his will to obey, 'twill enhance all the rapture of heaven when I've gone the last mile of the way. Amen. When I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the close of the day, and I know there are joys that await me when I've gone the last mile of the way. I'll see you in the morning, Brother Marion. God bless us. God bless you all.
I'm not the public speaker of this family, but I'm going to give it my best shot. The things I respect about my dad was his devotion to his faith. He was consistent for 60 years. He loved reading the Bible. Every morning he read the Bible. And Mom gave me the Bible that he used to read out of by the kitchen table with his cup of coffee. He had many favorite verses, and I just want to read a couple of verses to you that he loved so much. First one is Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And another favorite verse of his was John 14:1-6. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you so. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. And where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Then Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. There's a song that my dad loved, and really some meaningful words here. I just want you to listen. I'm going to read the lyrics to it. The song is called Only One Life. It matters so little how much you own, the places you've been or the people you've known, for it all comes to nothing when placed at his feet. It's nothing to Jesus, just memories to keep. You may take all the treasures from faraway lands, take all the riches you can hold in your hands, and take all the pleasures your money can buy, but what will you have when it's your time to die? The days pass so swiftly and the months come and go. The years melt away like new fallen snow. Spring turns to summer and summer to fall. Autumn brings winter, then death comes to call. And here's the chorus to that song. Only one life, so soon it will pass. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one chance to do his will. So give to Jesus all your days. It's the only life that pays when you recall you have but one life. And my father lived those words every day. And I love you, Dad.
So as you all have already heard, Grandma and Grandpa had about, 164 grandkids and a half. There's a couple buns in the oven. So I feel incredibly honored to be able to say a few words on behalf of the grandkids. I hope I represent you all well. As I sat and just thought about words that could describe Grandpa, for us grandkids, the word rock came to me. He was a rock to all of us. He was a figure of strength and security and comfort that we knew we could always find sitting at 2910 Tuxedo Avenue, waiting for us with a hug and a joke. And we just sit there and listen to his words that would instruct and comfort and guide. So much wisdom he gave. He would almost refuse to talk about himself and always wanted the updates on our lives. If you had a nickname for us, we'd hear it. If it was some sort of funny memory, we'd hear about that too. If it was something hard we were going through, he made sure to ask about it. He showed us his love in hundreds of tangible ways, attending events, graduations, birthday parties, playing games with us, making breakfast when we spent the night. I'll never forget his kielbasa cooking on the skillet whenever I woke up in the morning and spent the night. He'd take us on antique tours up in his attic. Oh, that mystical attic with so many wonders for little kids. He always had something kind to say. I love you. I'm proud of you. You can do it. I believe in you. That was Grandpa. He was a rock for us grandkids. But there's another thing about Grandpa, the biggest part of his life, it was how he'd bring everything back to Jesus at some point. The fact is that if he heard himself being referred to as a rock, he probably wouldn't be a huge fan of it, because the only rock that he acknowledged was the rock who God the Father made into the cornerstone, the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ. I could say a lot about Grandpa's faith, and I know more has been said and will be said, but I want to end by saying this. I got a unique chance to walk into the hospital room with my wife, Jessica, moments after the doctor walked out and just gave him the news of that he didn't have much longer to live. And he sat there and stared kind of into the blank distance for a few minutes, and then he started to speak. He spoke about Grandma and being worried about her being cared for. But then a few minutes after that, he started speaking about his grandkids and how concerned he was for his grandkids and his great-grandkids to follow Jesus. So, with that being said, I want to challenge you all with a couple words. For those of you who know you are following Jesus and know that you have a relationship with Jesus, a slight paraphrase from Philippians 3, press on to make the resurrection from the dead your own, because Christ has made you his own. Forget what lies behind and strain forward to what lies ahead. Press towards the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And then, for those of you who know deep down that as you're hearing that, you know you're not following Jesus. You don't know if he's your Savior and Lord. This is hard, but I offer a warning given by God through the prophet Isaiah. And even though it's a warning with hope attached to it. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. As long as you're drawing breath, forgiveness for your sins and peace with God are available to you through Jesus. Don't wait. Love you, Gramps.
Oh, boy. So I'm Matthew. I'm Dad's third son, the middle child that often got forgotten about. But I won't hold that against anybody, Tim or Tom, Mary Beth, Mark. No, I say that in jest. I never felt that way. But, you know, when you're a kid, you don't dream, but you think about that day. You know, what are you going to do when your dad passes away, or your mom? And how are you going to honor them? And unfortunately with Dad, according to him, he's dying since the age of 40. Ever since he turned 40, the phrase, "when I die," was in front of every sentence. You finally did it, Dad. You finally made it. And we used to joke about that all the time, especially at the dinner table. And he would joke about that, and we would joke right back, and he would always say, "We're gonna fight over his records," and my mom would find some guy in the next week, and so I don't think that's gonna happen, because I don't think we will allow that. So even about death, he had a joke, and unfortunately, in the soberness of the moment, you know, we have to say something serious, and rightly so. So last night, I sat in the Holy of Holies, his office, till 3:30 in the morning. And I sat in his chair. And I can remember as a little boy going into his office and just sitting there in awe. My dad, the preacher. I was always so fascinated with all his little trinkets on his desk and his Bibles and his sermons, and I literally, like I said, I felt like I was in the Holy of Holies last night just sitting there. And if you only knew what his office looked like. You've seen the show The Hoarders? Well, he was a hoarder, but it was Bibles, sermons, page after page, notebook after notebook of sermons. You can stack them up here. And I just sat there in that chair thinking, how many times has the Holy Spirit been in that room with him, been in that chair with him, just feeding him those thoughts and those sermons? And I know we took that for granted when he was with us at times. Kind of, we took it for granted. And that was just so overwhelming to me that, you know, I could experience that. You know. My dad sacrificed so much for us growing up. There were times he sold furniture just to pay bills, to buy us something for Christmas. He'd go out on the road and sacrifice his time with my mom and us to preach the word to others. And we were willing to let him do that, because we knew the eternal value that gave. So we never held it against him that he was not with us a lot of times, because we knew the eternal value was there and not our temporal time with him, if that makes sense. People loved him. He knew how to attract people, usually with his humor. A lot of self-deprecating humor at times. And he cared about people. If you ever wanted to meet a man that cared about your soul, right there. For almost 60 years he preached, and he was unwavering. Never compromised, always preached the word, always preached and said things that some people were afraid to say. But he knew that God was wanting him to say those things. He's not afraid of offending people, because he knew If he can offend you and get you to heaven, go for it. I found something last night. Now, Dad, you're going to have to forgive me for this in heaven someday. But I kind of broke into his diary from 1994. And I will give you a picture of the heart of this man for my mom. He wrote this on September 16th, 1994. He kept a year, that diary. Forgive me, Dad, for sneaking. Special thanks, my wife and the life with her, all the happiness and wonderful times we shared, her gentle spirit, her unselfish character, her tenderness and humbleness, her ageless beauty and consideration of me always. Speaking of him, truly, dear Jesus, she is the wind beneath my wings. Her love and care for my children, grandchildren, my daughter and sons-in-law, she bears the fruit of the Holy Ghost more than I ever will. Thank you for letting her be an example of godliness. That's just one entry in a whole year. And I also found in here times when he prayed for me. And I wandered from the Lord for about 6 years. So many things in here where he said, pray for Matt, pray for Matt. Pray that he'll get his life straight and come back to the Lord. I underlined it in here, but I'm not going to read it. But you parents out there that have kids that you're praying for, don't stop. Because one of these days, it'll pay off. My dad was a warrior, was his last name. That's what it meant, at least. I'm sorry I'm taking so long, Tom. I wrote a poem for him in honor of him being a warrior and a soldier of the cross. A call went out across the land saying, who will go? Whom shall we send? One who will guide the lost into my hand to preach the word and the cross defend. From among the elect, one stood tall. With trembling lips, this testimony was heard. Here I am, Lord, to receive your call, to fight the faith and preach your word. His helmet of salvation fastened in place, secured forever by the Father's seal, and loins girt with truth to run the race, to battle the deceiver with fervor and zeal. A plate for righteousness guards his heart, that his passion for souls may not decrease. From the narrow way he will not part, with feet prepared in the gospel of peace. Slashing his foes with the word of the Lord, piercing asunder the spirit and soul. For it is sharper than any two-edged sword, pressing towards the mark of his final goal. He defends the faith throughout the world, while to his shield he desperately clings. As Satan's darts at him are hurled, I will go on, this brave one sings. Forever encompassed in God's loving care, he marches forward by win or by loss, as day by day this is his prayer, to be a soldier of the cross. I wrote, dedicated to my father, my hero in the faith. On January 24th, when he passed away, there was a verse in my mom's Bible, a verse thing that she tears off every day. January 24th. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Then I said, here am I, send me. That was the verse. There's like a 1 in 11 million chance that this verse would be picked for that day that my dad passed away, out of all the verses in the Bible. And that was the first paragraph of that poem I wrote. But the miracle of that is I wrote this poem in 1995. So you see how God moves. He knew back in 1995 I would write those words and that this would be the verse of the day for him. Okay. Is this mic on?
But like I said before,
Dad always joked about what he's going to do at his funeral. He would often say, I don't want any Christians crying for me at my funeral. I'm going to get up out of that casket and tell you all to quit your crying. I'm with the Lord. And I think that if he could get up out of that casket, which I think this would be the song that he would sing. It's a song that best reflects, I think, his testimony of his life before the Lord. And when he found the Lord, and if I get through this, it'll be a miracle. Go ahead. Twas a life filled with aimless desperation, without hope, death, I've lost the words already. Shadow of a man, yes. Thanks. Then a hand with a nail print stretched downward. Just one touch, then a new life began. And the old rugged cross made the difference in a life bound for heartache and defeat. I will praise him forever and ever, for the cross made a difference for me. Barren walls echo harshness and anger. Little feet ran in terror to hide. Now those walls ring with love, warmth, and laughter, for the giver of life moved inside. Now there's a room filled with sad, ashen faces, without hope, death has wrapped them in gloom. But at the side of a saint there, rejoicing, for life can't be sealed in a tomb, and the old rugged cross made the difference in a life bound for heartache and defeat. I will praise him forever and ever, for the cross made the difference for me. For the cross made the difference for me.
Thank you, Matt and Mary Beth. and everyone else who have shared their hearts with us today. My name is David. I am the favorite son-in-law. And he would always make the point, you're my only son-in-law. And if I acted up, he would always threaten me with calling some of the crushes that Mary Beth had growing up. I'm going to call them. I will call them. I can kick you out of here real quick, son. These words are from Marion's youngest son, who's deaf, Mark. And so these are all his words that he wanted me to share with you today. My dad went home to be with Jesus. I will never forget you forever. No more pain, no more suffering, no more crying. I will also talk with my own voice when I will be in heaven with him. He is with my grandparents and three siblings that my mom miscarried. We will see him in heaven with Jesus. Jesus loves you all. And he just got my attention right before I came up here, and he said, I want you to read this verse. Isaiah chapter 29, verse 18. And in that day shall the deaf hear the words of the book, and the eyes of the blind shall see out of obscurity and out of darkness. Amen? Amen. And I think it's really cool that my father-in-law can share his own words. So if you can imagine, not this hill, he called me hillbilly, okay? If you can imagine his big booming voice reading these words, these are his words. This is him celebrating his beautiful life. And so these are his words written by Marion Wojnarowski. As boys, my brother David and I would pelt stones, dirt balls, rocks, and snowballs at the Dunikowski girls as they walked home from Union Elementary School on any given day. Little did we know that someday they would be our lifelong wives. It was in the dramatics class at South High School where I turned around and truly saw her for the first time, my dear Carolyn. Immediately, I fell in love with this wonderful beauty of a girl. At sweet 16, she became the love of my life and still is today, some 65 years later. We started to go steady on November 25th, 1957, and dated almost daily until February 6, 1960, when we were married at St. Stanislaus Parish in Cleveland, Ohio. I just slaughtered that, didn't I? Our first honey pad was a three-room apartment upstairs from her parents at 7044 Morgan Avenue. It was at this apartment where Tim and Tom were born. We then moved to our first house on East 103rd Street off of Union Avenue. We became parents of Matt and Mary Beth. It was in October of 1963 when Carolyn and I were born again of the Spirit of our Lord. Immediately, I entered the ministry of Jesus Christ. After pastoring a mission work called the Grace Memorial Baptist Church, we moved to Springfield, Missouri, where I attended the Baptist Bible College and pastored the Berean Fundamental Baptist Church for 3 years in Bolivar, Missouri. At our home on Cherry Street in Springfield, Missouri, our fourth son, Mark, was born. After graduating, we moved again to a home we rented on York Road in North Royalton, Ohio. I became the associate pastor of the Cleveland Baptist Church on Tiedemann Road. After some 16 months, I was called to pastor the Calvary Baptist Church in Connersville, Indiana, where I also established another mission church in Pershing, Indiana, called the New Testament Baptist Church. Feeling the call to go on into full-time evangelism, we moved back home to a home we bought in Olmsted Falls, Ohio, where we lived for the next 3.5 years. We then bought our present home in Parma, Ohio, where we have been living for the past 45 years. When we first moved to Parma, I began the Solon Baptist Temple in Solon, Ohio, where I pastored for almost 11 years. After this pastorate, I spent the last 21 years traveling in some 22 states, preaching to many churches. I'd also been to the country of Poland on three mission trips, preaching, and taking missionaries to this nation of my heritage. Carolyn stayed home most of the time, raising our children in my absence. I have traveled with my dear wife to churches, sharing his words, singing his music for the last 12 years. I was a chaplain in the city of Parma, mainly caring for the seniors of the Parma Senior Center. Carolyn and I have been on the board of the Parma Commission of Aging for the last 12 years. Carolyn is the vice president of the commission and also has the title of the Sunshine Lady, sending cards to all the sick and bereaved through the center. We are worn out ministry vagabonds, but we love it, and we wouldn't have it any other way. Besides my travels, I held a Coffee and More Bible class and mini concert every month, taught a low vision support group every week, and lectured to a monthly support group for folks who are grieving over their loss of loved ones. Every month I did this. I wrote a newsletter article for the Parma readers. We keep busy for Jesus. In spite of our nagging daily pains, Carolyn is my soulmate, partner, sidekick, advisor, critic, encourager, reminder, supporter, nurse, sunshine lady, gardener, sweetheart, and my darling girlfriend and loving wife. I think he liked you, Mom. What more could a man ask for? We go on one day at a time, waiting for our Lord to return to take us home, either by rapture or reunion. We will always be together because our Jesus is the cement of our welded souls and mingled lives. We were meant from the womb to the tomb to be one flesh through marriage. Through the pain and through the rain, the ups and downs, the joys and the sorrows, the tears and the cheers, the blessings and the burdens, let me tell all my dear listeners, we are definitely victorious survivors in a world of marital failures. Dr. Marion Edmund Wojnarowski, one of my heroes and the warrior. I love you. God bless you all. Thank you for being here and for praying for our family.
I have so many wonderful memories that I had with my dad. When I was a boy, yes, he's my daddy, but he was my hero. I loved watching him preach the Word of God. There were no holds barred. He reared back and just let it happen. And the Holy Spirit of God flowed through that man's mouth, that mouth that I heard at home, too, mind you. So it was kind of puzzling how the Lord could use Dad's mouth sometimes. But you know, if that were the case, that God could not use us because of our imperfections, none of us would be usable. My dad knew how to apologize. He knew how to make things right. He knew how to win back our hearts with just a simple hug and kneeling by our bed before he went to bed and assured us of his love. He was a very opinionated man, if you knew him. And that rubbed off on all of his DNA, which was passed on to his children. And so I was the one out of the five that, of the four boys, that surrendered to the ministry. And I preached my first sermon under Dad's ministry. I sang my first solo in church under Dad's ministry. I was ordained to the gospel ministry under Dad's ministry. He led me to Christ. He baptized me. He was an example for me on how to live life, not as a perfect man, but as a sinner saved by grace. Nevertheless, because we are opinionated people, he and I butted heads many times. He wanted to change me, I wanted to change him, and that neither worked. And so we butted heads a lot. I have to say that the last 13 years, my dad was not only my hero, he became my friend. And we enjoyed many alone times together. And that alone time was highlighted there in the hospital room when I held his hand and my mom held the other, and we witnessed him opening his eyes, looking at the ceiling, and I believe with all my heart, like Stephen, saw the heavens opened and Jesus standing at the right hand, welcoming him into heaven. What a gift that God gave me. My dad was there for my first breath. I was there for his last. I am humbled by that gift. There were some things my dad would never budge on. One was, this book is the very word of God. If we don't agree with it, he would say, pot on you. If someone tried to explain it away through science, well, they're wrong. God's word endures forever, period. And my dad preached it. And that's how he could preach unapologetically. Because what that book says is the truth, and we will all, every single one of us, give an account to God one day for what we do with the words in that book. Another thing that he was unflinching on was his love and care for not only all people, but for his children, his grandchildren, and his great-grandchildren. I did not see this as selfishness when he said many times that he wants to be in heaven with all of his children. And he prayed for everyone in our family. What profit is it if a man loses his own soul but gains the whole world? Dad knew what was valuable. If you're going to take a chance on anything in this life, don't take a chance without Jesus. Gamble your life on him. He'll understand the little bit of doubt that you have. Like the man in the New Testament said, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. It's okay that you unbelief a little bit. God will help you with that in time as you grow. Give your life to him. One more thing he was so unflinching on was that he looked forward to the second coming of Jesus Christ. He would wake up in the morning, get out of bed, after he would creak and crack for a little bit and make sure everything's in place, and he would open up his shade and look out at the sky and said, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus, and he went on with his day. He wanted to be raptured out of this world before he died. He believed that he would. In fact, he even predicted at one point when Jesus would return. Of course, we're still here. But Jesus will return, and he'll tell you that. So he never budged on that. Interesting, when I thought about my dad's life, this memory of mine came back. My dad standing over on this side of the platform at Cleveland Baptist Church. And he stood there with his white accordion, and he sang this wonderful song called Until Then. Until Then. I'm going to try to sing it like my dad did. And thank you, my dear sister, for my partner in singing.
My heart can see when I pause to remember a heartache here is but a stepping stone along a trail that's winding always upwards. This troubled world is not my final home. value if we recall their borrowed for a while and things of earth that cause the heart to tremble.
My dad wrote the words. This is great. Listen to this now.
Dear child of God, stand fast upon his promise till he returns to welcome home his own. But until then, win souls for Jesus daily, and you shall meet him there at his throne. But until then, my heart will go on singing. Until
tribute. You all did a fantastic job. I so much love having funerals in a church. It always bugged me. Kim, I don't mean any disrespect to you, but for a person to spend their life in a church, give their money, serve, share their talents and gifts, to come to the day that they die and we ship them off to a funeral home for service. I love having funerals at a church. I love it because this is home. We feel more comfortable here. I can be at ease. I can be myself here. Brother Marion could always be himself here. And sometimes you would say, did he really say that? And sometimes Carolyn would sit in the back there and she'd roll her eyes. Yeah, he said that. I, too, shared a common interest with Brother Marion. I love to tell jokes. I love to have fun. Matter of fact, there's a picture that Mary Beth took when my wife and I went to the hospital to visit Brother Marion, and I was kneeling down next to his bed, and we were together, and I don't know if you heard me, but whenever I knelt down there, I said, "Forgive me, Father, for you have sinned." But he was a jokester. He enjoyed it, which I feel comfortable. I wouldn't normally feel comfortable in telling a joke at a funeral, but I feel comfortable today to do that. These three gentlemen all passed away at the same day, and they all got up to, you know how we usually say, they got up to the heaven's gate, and St. Peter met them, and St. Peter said to the first guy, he said, "You know, your funeral is going to be in just a couple of days." He said, "What would you like for people to say about you?" And he said, "Well, I'd like for them to say I was a good, faithful husband. I was a good father, a good man." And he said, "Okay." Second man stepped up. He said, "Your funeral is going to be in a few days, too." He said, "What would you like for people to say about you?" He said, "Well, I'd like for people to say about me, I was a teacher, and I invested my life into a lot of people. And I'd like for people to say I influenced a lot of people in my life." The third gentleman stepped up, and St. Peter said, "What would you like for people to say about you?" He said, "I would like for somebody to come up and say, 'Hey, he moved.'" Forgive me. But Brother Marion would tell that joke. Marion always preached points. And all of those points sometimes would start with the same letter. What a mind to be able to do all of that and put all of that together. And a lot of work, a lot of preparation. I mean, I'm sure he burned that typewriter up several times back there in the back with all of that. And I remember one of the very first times that I had Brother Marion preach here. When I was pastoring, I said, "Brother Marion, it's Mother's Day. I'd like for you to preach." And so he stood up and he said, "I am preaching from Proverbs 31 today about the Proverbs 31 woman. I have 31 points." Now you laugh, but have you ever had a mean, or not a mean, but an angry nursery worker come to you after 31 point sermon? Sherry, I think you did that. But that was Marion, all right? That was Marion. So today, in honor of Brother Marion, I have 31 points. 31 responses to what he did when he entered the throne room of glory. Who are we kidding? He only had one response. "Abba, Father, Papa." That was his response when he got into heaven. I invite you to turn with me, if you have your Bibles, or there's pew Bibles in the back of the pew, if you'd like to use one, to the book of 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 4. And while you're turning there, let me just sum up what these four chapters are talking about. And then I'll park on just a few verses. Paul is in prison, and he is awaiting execution at any moment. And he says to young Timothy, who is pastoring at the church of Ephesus, he says, "Timothy, they are coming for me. They're going to kill me for preaching the gospel." And he said, "When they come for me, Timothy, you take my place in preaching the gospel until they come for you to kill you." Now that's encouraging, isn't it? How would you like to have that kind of a transition? Right? But at any moment, they could come for Paul and execute him. And he says, "Timothy, you take my place." Transition. Succession. Every institution needs a good transition. And we had a transition here whenever I was no longer pastor and Pastor Bill became pastor. Institutions, businesses have transitions all the time. But we as believers also have transitions. Brother Marion has transitioned from here to glory. And every believer is to be about pouring their life into the life of other people. Discipleship. Winning people to Christ and then discipling them. Brother Marion has transitioned. Somebody's got to step up and take his place in doing what he did. And Paul says, I'm getting ready to die. And he says in that second chapter, look at chapter 2, 2 Timothy chapter 2, and verse 2, it says, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. I want to talk to you today about how to keep on in the race, how to keep running the race and end well, like Brother Marion did. Look at chapter 4, and then we'll have a word of prayer. Chapter 4, he says in verse 1, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. We're there, folks. We're there. The time will come when will not endure sound doctrine. But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure the afflictions, do the work of the evangelist, Evangelist Marion Ward Norowski. Do the work of the evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Shall we pray? Father, I pray today that you would bless as I share the word of God today. Thank you, Lord, for what we've heard already. Thank you for the wonderful tribute to this great man, this great preacher, this great husband, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, friend. I pray that you'd help us all today to finish our race as he did. In Jesus' name, amen. When I went to visit Brother Marion in the hospital, he was just told to take chemo, and if he did, that he would be given 10 months to live. Without the treatment, he would only be given 1 month to live. Now, I thank God for doctors, and I thank God for all the ways that they help us. But can I tell you, they're not God. They're not God. Because our Heavenly Father decided to bring Brother Marion home sooner than 10 months. When I heard that news, I thought, if I knew that I had 10 months to live, would it change the way I live? Would it cause me to do some things differently? How about you? If you heard you had 10 months to live, would it affect your life? I suspect it would affect all of us if we only had 10 months to live. By the way, none of us know how much more time we do have. For some of us, it could be 9 minutes. For some, it could be 9 weeks. For some, it could be 10 weeks. For some, it could be 10 months. For some, it could be 10 years. I don't know. But none of us know. And truth be known, and you will agree with me, we all have some things in our past, in our lives, that we're not proud of. some things that we would like to forget, and some things that if we had a chance to do over, we would definitely probably try to do differently. But the question comes, how can you and I finish well? How can we learn from Brother Marion's life on how to finish well? I want to share three things with you today. Number one, live without fear. Live without fear. I think Brother Marion lived without fear. Live without fear. A heart that is fearless is a gift from God. And it means that a child of God is a child of God. You don't have to fear anything. You don't even have to fear death, according to what God says. You know, there's a lot of fear in our world today. Way too much. There's the fear of COVID. Should I take the shot? What are we up to now? Six, seven, eight shots? I don't know. Should I take the shot? What about monkeypox and all the other poxes that are coming down the road? What about the economy? I mean, it sure does stink. People are worried about the political situation. Who's in power? Who's not in power? Gas prices. People are concerned about that. Eggs. I want you to know, my wife and I were just approved for a loan to buy 2 dozen eggs the other day. But there's so much fear in our world today. But probably the biggest fear that people do have would be death. When am I going to die? How am I going to die? Woody Allen is often quoted for saying, I don't fear death, I just don't want to be there when it happens. Well, the Christian doesn't only mind when it happens, but there is sort of a sense in which we look forward to death. Not in a morbid way, but because we know that death is not the end, folks. But in many ways, it's merely the end of the beginning. I mean, what can be so bad about heaven for the believer? Verse 6 says, for I am now ready. I'm ready to be offered up. It's time for me to die, Paul says, and I am ready. Paul viewed his life as one of being poured out as an offering. A living sacrifice. And only if we could just see ourselves as Romans 12:1 puts it, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. You can live a fearless life when you regard yourself as a worship offering unto the Lord. Living for Christ, hey, not just at death, but living at every point in life for Christ. Marion impacted. He impacted his family. I think we've all been blessed today by listening to how the family has been impacted. And if you're looking for a Wojnarowski, just look for a shiny, bald head. You'll find one. I don't know how you made it. And Mary Beth, for sure, I don't know how you know. But he impacted his family. They loved this man. Whatever relation, grandfather, great-grandfather, brother, sister, the family loved him. And, you know, families are so fractured today. I hope this is not true for any of your family, that there's some out there that are just mad and they won't come. I mean, maybe there is. I don't know, all right? But to see this many come, I mean, it's great, all right? And there's probably some that couldn't be here today, right? But he impacted his family, right? And he wanted them to know Christ as their personal Savior. That's his greatest, that was his greatest goal. Many times he would say, pray for so-and-so, pray for so-and-so. You know, they need prayer, right? He impacted them. He impacted his church, right? We loved him here at Columbia Road Baptist Church. And many times he ministered and he preached and he would sing songs and he would minister to people that needed ministering to. He impacted his community. Last night, one of the gentlemen from the city of Parma came in with a little certificate, and it's placed in his casket, a citizenship award from Parma, the city of Parma. And he impacted people there as a chaplain, served as a chaplain for the city of Parma, and ministered, probably to countless number of people. I was looking through some of the articles that he had written for people in a newsletter. For those shut-ins, for those people that can't get out, there was somebody there for them. He, he impacted his fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. He impacted a lot of preachers. I wonder how many preachers were called into the ministry under Marion Wojnarowski's preaching and life. Called to the ministry to preach. We miss him. We miss him. We miss him because his light, the light of Jesus Christ shone through him unto us. And that's one of the reasons we miss him. And we will continue to miss him. Will people miss you when you die? Will they miss you? Or will they say, boy, I'm glad he's gone. Boy, I'm glad she's gone. In a cemetery in England, there's a tombstone for a woman named Anna Wallace. And it reads, the children of Israel wanted bread. The Lord sent them manna. Old man Wallace wanted a wife, and the devil sent him Anna. How will you be remembered? What will your legacy be? As I said, imagine the souls that were saved under Brother Marion's ministry. Imagine the preachers that were helped and called. The people that were blessed over the years. Marion was ready to go. I don't think he wanted to leave right away, but he was ready. He had his bags packed, right? He knew where he was headed, and that was settled long ago. Do you know where you're going? You know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior? If you don't know him, today would be a great day to trust him before it's too late, so that you can finish well also and know where you're going. Verse 6 goes on, the time of my departure is at hand. What a great phrase that is. The time of my departure. That word is a word that's often used to describe a number of actions. Departure. If I could give you a picture of what that might be, it would be like a captain of a sea vessel taking up the anchor so that the ship can depart. And what was that ship going to do? It's going to depart one harbor and go to the next harbor. That's simply what Brother Marion did today. He left the harbor here and went to another harbor. Someone wrote this poem, say not he has gone, nor even think of him as dead, but say, in my Father's house, he has arrived. Think about it. In my Father's house, Marion Edmund Wojnarowski has arrived. Amen. Departure means to arrive. Hey, Marion's not dead. He's not dead. He just moved from one harbor to the next harbor. Amen. Paul longed for that departure. He said in Philippians 1:23, "For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better." I think Marion struggled with that. He didn't want to go for your all's sake. All right? He didn't want to leave you, Carolyn. And he struggled. You live a life that way, and you will be fearless. And you will finish well. Let me say, secondly, be faithful. Be faithful. Paul says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith." Paul said, "I have been faithful to the finish line." Notice all of those are words of action. Fought, finished, kept. Hey, folks, the Christian life is not for sissies. The Christian life can be hard and difficult at times. And Paul's life was not easy. Listen to me as I read for you out of the book of Corinthians. It says, and this is describing Paul, "Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths oft. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods, once I was stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day I've been in the deep. In journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils of mine own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst and fastings often, in cold and nakedness." Hey, don't stop running. Don't stop running the race. Our race is not done yet. We're still here. We're still running the race. No matter how difficult the race you have, keep on running. You know, the Bible uses a metaphor to illustrate the Christian life, and it is a race. Have you ever heard somebody get up and talk about running a marathon? I know Pastor Steve always talks about running a marathon, and I used to always feel guilty about not being able to do all that kind of stuff, and I certainly wouldn't want to try it now, that kind of a marathon. But I began to think about it. I said, hey, I'm doing a marathon. We're in a marathon. Hey, don't ever feel guilty when you hear somebody get up and talk about that. If you are a child of God, you are running a marathon. If you're a Christian, you're running one. Meadowlark Lemon said, "Life's most meaningless statistic is the halftime score." Hey, look, folks, it's halftime for us. The game's not over. Keep on running. Keep on winning people to Christ. Keep on discipleship. Keep on ministering. Keep on preaching the gospel. Keep on sharing Jesus. It's only halftime for us. A little over 2 weeks ago, I believe Brother Marion saw the finish line. I believe he did. Matter of fact, he may have even saw it at your last Christmas celebration. Okay. He knew the finish line was just ahead. And by God's grace, I'm still running. How about you? By God's grace, I'm still running the race. When I was a young man, oh, those were the days. When I was young, I'm now old, but when I was young, I had great dreams and aspirations. I would sit as a teenage boy, and I would listen to Brother Marion preach. Now, I'm not lying, all right? Am I lying? Okay, I'm not lying. As a teenage boy, okay, when he was at Cleveland Baptist Church, I would sit and I would listen to him preach. He just started. Okay, Brother Virgil, you were there. He just started. Brother David, you guys both just started. I would listen to you. I would listen to Brother Marion. I'd listen to great preachers like Dr. Thompson and Brother Larry Clayton And on and on I could go, listening to Brother Bruce Musselman and names that I could spend all day mentioning. But I would listen to them preach, and I would say, oh, man, one of these days, if I could just preach like they preach. I had great dreams. But you know what is filling my mind right now? Just to get to the finish line. I just want to get to the finish line. The Bible talks about some who did not finish. And I'm not going to elaborate on that very long, but I'll just read a passage of Scripture. It says in 1 Timothy 4, 9 and 10, "Do thy diligence to come shortly unto me." He's talking to Timothy. He says, "For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica, Cretans to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia." God help us to be like Paul. God help us to be like Acts 20 and verse 24. "But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home." Number three, to finish well, we need to keep our eyes on heaven. To finish well, we need to keep our eyes on heaven. 2 Timothy 4 and verse 8 says, "Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." What day is he talking about? He's talking about the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, when Jesus came the first time, he came as a humble servant. When he comes again, he's going to come as King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the conquering King, when he comes a second time. And then we will receive crowns. The victor's crown for one. And you know what? None of us are worthy of them. And we're going to lay them at the feet of Jesus, because he's worthy. And then we'll be rewarded on our faithfulness. You know, this life can be difficult. Marion was not perfect. But neither am I. And neither are you, by the way. None of us are perfect. Marion went to heaven not based on his own merits, but he went there based upon the grace of Almighty God. He went there by God's grace. He was bruised. He had some battles. Oh, we'd talk about it. He had some battles along the way. He had a lot of friends. He made some enemies along the way, as Paul did. He was battled. He was bruised. He gained some friends. He gained enemies, by the way. But you know what? He kept his eyes on heaven. He kept his eyes on the goal. Don't live in the present. Don't give up. Don't get comfortable here. Folks, we're just passing through. Amen? This is not our home. We're just a passing through. Keep your eyes on heaven. Keep your eyes on the prize. Keep your eyes on Papa, right? As Brother Marion would say, because he's coming soon. Keep your eyes on the sky for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, I don't know if I'll get to see him come back that way. It'd be nice to, wouldn't it? But I don't know if I will. Brother Marion, I think somebody mentioned, wanted to see that happen. And by the way, I haven't predicted it. All right, so and don't plan on it. Oh, that just shows you the humanness of people, doesn't it? That makes me love Brother Marion more. You know, when I heard that. But Jesus is a wonderful Savior. If I could just say a word to the family, and you know, with a large family like you have, it's possible that someone doesn't know Jesus. It's possible that someone is not walking with Jesus. Right? And the best thing you could do for your own self is to get your life and heart right with the Lord. If you don't know Him, trust Him today before it's too late. Make a commitment today. I am going to finish well like my grandfather, like my husband, like my father, like my great-grandfather, like my friend. Because we have a good example here. Someone who fought the battle and someone who finished well. Let's bow our heads in prayer. I would feel guilty if I did not do this. Number one is a minister of the gospel answering to the Lord. And then also in Brother Marion's honor. Do you know Jesus Christ today? Do you know Him as your personal Savior? I wonder, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, maybe you'd say, "Preacher, I don't know Christ. I've never asked Jesus into my heart. I don't know if I go to heaven today, if I died or not. Would you pray for me?" Is anybody like that at all? And you just lift up your hand, let me pray for you. I promise I won't embarrass you. I'll pray for you. Anybody at all? Here's my hand, preacher. Pray for me. Anybody at all? All right. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand on this next one, but would you just lift your heart up to the Lord and say, "Lord, help me today to finish well. Not just finish, but Lord, help me to finish my race well. That I might hear when I get to heaven, 'Well done, thou good and faithful servant.'" Father, thank you today for the opportunity to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the opportunity to memorialize and talk about this great man of God, my friend. I pray, Lord, that you would bless us as we leave this place today. Bless the family as they proceed to the cemetery. I pray that you'd give them grace today. Help them in the days to come. I pray for Sister Carolyn. I know it's going to be tough. I pray that you would minister to her. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Just before I turn it over to Brother or Pastor Bill, Galarakis, but everybody calls him Pastor G, okay? It's easier than trying to pronounce that name. So he has always been so gracious to allow me to come back, as I had pastored this church so many years, to come back and to do some of the funerals here at the church, and I've always appreciated that. As a final act, could I ask you, and I warned you that I was going to do something weird at the end, but Brother Marion was a man that really believed strongly in the church. He also believed that you ought to be a member of a Bible-believing, Christ-honoring church. Right? I'll put Baptist in there just because I know that's what Marion would say. But could you come and have a little business meeting and transfer Brother Marion's membership to heaven since he's up there? Would you do that?
Do that. Okay. Normally, a pastor gets a little upset when church members leave. Now, there's a few times they left and we didn't get upset. But I can say today with the utmost sincerity that though I will miss having Brother Marion as a member of our church, I could not be any more happy than to commend his membership into the heavenly host, surrounded the throne of our great Savior. And so I would ask for a first and then a second as we make a motion here in a business meeting. Do I have a first to transfer Brother Marion's? We got a first. Anybody willing to second it? Second it? Pastor Steve, Ron, we've got a second. All in favor of Brother Marion's membership being transferred, may it be known by a hearty amen.
Amen.
Amen. There we go. Well, since we had a business meeting, I think we have to pass the plate now, don't we have to? No, we don't have to do that. If you're able to, would you stand with me? We're going to have a closing prayer, and then we're going to turn things over to the folks from the funeral home. Thank you once again for being here today. Thank you for the kindness that you've shown to the family and all the effort that you made. May the Lord bless you for it. Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful for our dear brother's life. Thank you for all the things that he's taught me, invested in me, for all of us that are here, the love that he's shown, the Christ-likeness that he's shown. I pray that you would bless now as we go with your grace, with your presence, that we might sense it, that we might have the peace that passes all understanding. I pray that you would hold us so close to you during these days, and may we keep our eyes on heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, you can be seated, and we'll turn things over to our funeral director.